All right, so lesson 35 here. See, the story of Jesus stills the tempest. Okay, so Mark chapter 4, starting there at verse 35. If you remember, we ended with Jesus with his five short parables. Last one there being the one right above it, at least the mustard seed. Okay, but verse 35. The same day, when the even was come, he saith unto them, Let us pass over unto the other side. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him, even as he was in the ship. And there were also with him other little ships. And there arose a great storm, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full. Stop there a second. So imagine, right? There's Jesus and his disciples. It says it's evening. It's nighttime, or it's getting to be nighttime. Jesus has been preaching and teaching and working all day. He's worn out. We have to remember, he had a physical body just like we do. And he's worn out. He's tired. He's ready to put his head down to rest somewhere. Jesus and his disciples get into the ship. You have to remember, they were fishermen, so this is not something new to them. They very easily get into the ship, and they begin to cross the sea. They push off, they cast off from the seashore. You can imagine each of them taking naturally back into their roles, one of them raising the sails, others of them grabbing the oars and rowing so that they can get out into the sea a bit, others pulling up the anchor. Right? This is something that was not new to them. In fact, they probably almost look forward to doing this, going back to the things that they had done in their former occupation, as many of them were fishermen. And others of the disciples who weren't fishermen, maybe they enjoyed watching their brethren, seeing them work. For I'm sure they've told stories of, well, this one day when I was out on the sea or this or that, and they could see their brethren here doing this work in the ship. But anyways, they begin to cast off, and Jesus must have gone down into the lower part of the ship and found a place to lay his body and his head. And there, Jesus rests. He sleeps. The other disciples, of course, are rowing out to sea or using the sails, and soon, probably, which is very common in the evening time, the winds are moving. And if we know anything about the air up in the mountains, generally air up in the mountains is what temperature? What temperature generally is the air up in the mountains? Garrett, cold. And the air over a sea, however, is what temperature generally, Jesse? And what happens when cold and warm air mix? Faith? Yeah, storms begin to brew. Okay? And so that happens with quite frequently here on the sea, on the Sea of Galilee. And so here on this evening, God determines so that in his providence this lesson can be brought to the disciples. And so God sends some cold air to come swooping down out of the mountains. And it mixes with the warm air on the sea. And the tempest arises, so much so that the waves begin to build up. The winds begin to howl and blow. There's great power in that storm. You can see God's handiwork. While the disciples here on the ship, I'm sure some of them right away, who aren't used to being on the seas, begin to feel a bit seasick. It's uncomfortable for them. They begin to get worried. For the ship is rolling on those waves up and down and up and down. The waves continue to get larger. Now they're crashing over the side of the boat, washing the water across the deck, and it becomes something dangerous. Even the seasoned fishermen who have spent their lives out here have not seen a storm like this. And they too become afraid that the boat will capsize, it will tip over in the storm. The waves are crashing over even larger. They pull down the sails so as the wind won't blow over the ship. And they probably, with all their strength and their might, use those oars to keep the ship properly pointed into the waves so that it won't easily tip over sideways and capsize and they'll all drown out here. And then they remember the Lord is with them. Not great faith of the Lord of heaven that they should have, that God is always with them, but they remember Jesus is sleeping down in the hull of the ship and maybe He can do something to help them. So they go down into the belly of the ship and they call Him. They speak to Him. Even though they're experienced seamen, they are afraid. And they show they have little faith. Instead, they run down to Jesus here. And they ask Him, they hope that He can do something. They should have had great faith. They know that God, the time of Jesus to die is not yet come. They should know that God would never kill His Son, His only begotten Son, drown Him in a storm. Now God could perform a miracle to deliver Him. But they are afraid. And so they go down and they call on Jesus. Is Jesus a seaman? Does He know how to steer the ship? No. So why do they go down to Him? Well, of course they go down to Him because they've seen His miracles and His wonders. They felt safe with Him. And so you read there, and He was in the hinder part of the ship asleep on a pillow. And they awake Him and say unto Him, Master, carest Thou not that we perish? And He arose and rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, Peace, be still. And the wind ceased and there was a great calm. And He said unto them, Why are ye so fearful? How is it that ye have no faith? And they feared exceedingly and said one to another, What manner of man is this that even the wind and the sea obey Him? So when Jesus is woken up and He sees the rolling waves, He rebukes the wind. Now think of a rebuke. Rebuke is a word where you chastise, you holler at something, you rebuke them, you tell them that they're wrong. Jesus rebukes the wind here. It should not come up like this. So we see Jesus rebuke the wind. Be still. Be calm. And immediately, the seas are calm. Now that boat sits there on the water, not rocking and rolling, almost tipping over, but very still. Maybe they put the sails back up, but I'm guessing with the wind being still, they're going to have to row their way to shore. And then Jesus also points out to the disciples, How is it that ye have no faith? Why is it that ye are so fearful? You shouldn't have been afraid. God always watches over you. He's always with you. And so the disciples learn a great lesson here. They see the power of Jesus that, yes, even the wind and the waves and the sea obey Him. Let's look at some pictures here, though. There's some good pictures for us about God's heavenly kingdom. The sea, what do you think the large sea is a picture of? The sea is a picture of what? What might the sea have been a picture of? Logan, what do you think? The earth? Hey? Jesse? Church? Anybody else have some ideas? The sea is a picture of the earth. It's the whole world that we live in. That's what the sea is a picture of. Okay? There are many ships on this because we saw that when the ship cast out, there were other ships around it. So on the sea are many ships, many groups of people. But one ship is special. The ship with Christ in it is a picture of, now Jesse, the church. Okay, the ship that has the disciples on it and Christ, that ship is a picture of the church. What do you think the storms that brew on the sea are a picture of? The storm that came up here. What's that a picture of? Faith? Temptation. Might be temptations. What is it a picture of? What in our lives might it be a picture of? Micah? Satan. Okay, could be Satan. Jen? Could be sin. Think of just though the whole tempest. Again, this is the world, and the boat is a church. So we're thinking a lot of individual things. Grant? Okay, the wicked, they're going to be on the other ships. The storm is like a storm in your life. What might be something that's a storm in your life? If we go back, temptations, what the devil brings to us. So those are things. The troubles, the difficulties, the trials in this life that we face, those are the storms. Okay, the storm that comes, that tosses the church to and fro and up and down, that those disciples are in. It's a picture of the troubles and the trials and the battles that the church must face in this world. Our church doesn't face very many battles right now other than teaching and guiding the people to live a godly life and to avoid the sin and wickedness of the world. But as a whole, the church isn't threatened. The government isn't breathing down our necks and telling us what we can and can't preach yet. The government isn't telling us that you can't have a Bible or you can only worship on these certain times or dates or you can only worship this type of God or you can or cannot preach these types of things. So in that sense, the church, although it's always in the storms of this life and fighting against sin and Satan and his temptations, and Satan comes very subtly sometimes too, but we see that here. So Jesus has to rebuke them for their little faith. Okay? So we see that. But now let's go on to the next part of Mark there, chapter 5, verse 1. And it speaks to what happens after that. I'm guessing that all through the night they were on that ship so that when the sea is calmed here, it's maybe the next morning. Okay? That's what I read here in Mark chapter 5. And they came over unto the other side of the sea, into the country of the Gadarenes. And when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit, who had his dwelling among the tombs, and no man could bind him, no, not with chains, because that he had been often bound with fetters and chains, and the chains had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broken in pieces. Neither could any man tame him, and always, night and day, he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. Let's stop there. So the disciples and Jesus in the ship, they row slowly to shore, right? They throw out an anchor so that the ship won't get away, and they get out of the boat and they walk to shore. And as they come up to the shore, here comes a man out of the tombs, out of the caves there. Probably can imagine Jesus calling this man in a sense forth. He's calling the devil to teach him a lesson here. Jesus, like just like when Jesus went into the wilderness to be tempted, okay, Jesus went to the devil. And here we can see the man comes out of the tomb, so maybe it's as though Jesus is calling this man out of the tombs with his unclean spirit. But let's take a look at this man a second. Here he is dwelling in these caves and these tombs away from any other people. Why? Why is he out here? Well, the reason is because he was a danger to those in society around him. This devil that overtook this man caused him to do all kinds of horrible, wicked things. Maybe hurt others. Be mean to others. Maybe even almost take their lives or kill them. So that the people are in the town are afraid of him. And so, what do? Well, they tie him up. Let's wrap up this man with some chains. Let's bind him. Let's wrap him up with some ropes so that he can't get out. And that way we'll be safe. Then he won't be able to harm us or our children. We'll be safe finally from this man with this devil. But even the chains and ropes that bind this man, it's as though he's like Samson with this special power, if we think back to Samson. He can break these chains and these ropes very easily. Okay? No man could tame him. And so it is that they finally have to send him away. He, in his moments, in his mind, when he wasn't overpowered by the devil, probably desired to be with his brethren. He loved them. He wanted to be with his family too. But when the devil would overtake him, there was nothing he could do, and he knew he must leave. Maybe he had children and family members of his own that he was afraid of killing or hurting. But he can break anything that they put him into, and he's not safe living amongst them. So he goes out. goes into the mountains, into these tombs, and there he spends his days, a spirit from time to time over, or the devil overtaking him, causing him to take stones and cutting himself and causing pain and affliction to himself now. Now instead of doing it to others, he's doing it to himself. Okay. When Jesus comes up to the shore, this man is in his right mind. Because look at verse 6. When he saw Jesus afar off, he ran and worshipped him. He knows this man can help me. And so he's still in his right mind and he takes off and he goes to Jesus. He worships him. The devils, though, quickly take over this man and begin controlling his tongue and his mind once again. And so the devil cries out with a loud voice and say, What have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God? I adjure thee by God that thou torment me not. This devil knows that this is Jesus. This devil knows, cannot hide. I adjure thee by God that thou torment me not. The devil knows who this is. This devil wants to remain in the man, and so it asked Jesus not to be cast out. But Jesus in verse 8, for he saith unto them, come out of the man, thou unclean spirit. And he asked them, what is thy name? Jesus asked him, what is your name? And he answered, saying, my name is Legion, for we are many. This man isn't just possessed with one devil, but many devils. How great his soul has been, well, not destroyed, but overtaken by this devil. This devil, group of devils, many devils overtakes this man's spirit and soul. God allows the devils to do that for this time so that while Jesus is walking on earth, he can cast out those devils to show that he has power over them. Well, the devils know that it's their time to be cast out. And so they begged Jesus here in verse 10, and he besought him much that he would not send them away out of the country. Please, Jesus, don't send us away. Instead, well, we look at the next verse, verse 11. Now there were nigh in the mountains, unto the mountains, a great herd of swine feeding, and all the devils besought him, saying, send us into the swine that we may enter into them. They didn't want to be cast. If they were cast out of this man, where would they return? To hell. That's the place of these devils. Hell. And they did not want to return there. So they look for anywhere else that they can go. Jesus, there's some swine over there. Please don't send us. Send us into those swine that we may remain here on this earth. And so Jesus does. Jesus forthwith gave them leave, and the unclean spirits went out and entered into the swine. And the herd ran violently down a steep place into the sea. They were about 2,000 and were choked in the sea. So as much as these wicked devils wanted to avoid their banishment from this earth and their return to hell in the end, they go into the swine and the swine behave miserably. The swine take off for the water and their crazed minds that are taken over by these devils and they run into the water, something they wouldn't normally do, and they're drowned. And so the devils are sent back to hell anyways here. So, verse 14, and they that fed the swine and told it in the city and in the country and went out to see what it was that was done. And they come to Jesus and see him that was possessed with the devil and had the legion sitting and clothed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. And they that saw it told them how it befell to him that was possessed with the devil and also concerning the swine. And they began to pray him to depart out of their coasts. And when he was come into the ship that had been possessed with the devil, prayed him that he might be with him. Howbeit Jesus suffered him not, but said unto him, go home to thy friends and tell them how great things the Lord hath done for thee and how he hath compassion on thee. When those swine run into the water and die, word gets back to the village, to the men who own them, and they come out into the countryside to see Jesus. And first of all, here they see this man who they've known their whole life, who's been possessed with the devil, who they're afraid of, and they probably come up You can imagine them walking up in a way that's a bit fearful because they're afraid of this man. They know he could lash out them at any time and put his hands around their necks and do whatever he wanted to them when he has so much power. They've seen him break those chains and they're afraid. But as they get closer, they see him sitting there under control of his own body, clothed. He's not ripping his clothes as he normally does, but he's clothed. They can even see that he's in his right mind. Something has changed about this man. But yet at the same time, they're concerned about their swine. And so this man tells them exactly what's happened. Jesus has healed me. He's cast out my devils. They went into the swine that you owned, and those swine took off for the water, and they are all now drowned, all 2,000 of them or so. Of course, the owners of the swine, how do they feel about this grant? They'd be happy to come out in the morning and see 2,000, actually not that many, 900 calves dead. Oh, that wouldn't be good, would it? You can imagine they'd be upset, and they are. This is their livelihood. But it was a wrong livelihood for them to pursue as Jews. Why? Why is this a livelihood they should not have pursued, Garrett? Right. Right. It's a good lesson for us. If you decide to own a business someday, well, I've got a business that uses the internet. Are you going to allow people to place orders to buy and sell on Sunday? Well, I'll open a restaurant. I won't work there on Sunday, but I'll let my other employees work there. Ooh, I could make some money with this company, but it includes something that looks a little bit like gambling. Well, that's okay. I'm not the one doing it. No, if you own a company, we should make sure that we follow God's laws in our ruling of that company too. So these Jews, they were doing work that showed that they didn't care about God's laws. They had swine. So they're upset. But they maybe are learning a lesson here from Jesus. But anyways, they asked Jesus to leave. Depart. They show that they don't want anything to do with Jesus. They cared more about their swine than they do about Jesus. They'd rather have their 2,000 swine back than to have the good godly words of Jesus and the lessons that Jesus is teaching. This man then who had the devil cast out of him, he wants to, as the disciples and Jesus get back into the ship, he wants to go with them, but Jesus says, no, stay. Go back to your family and friends and tell them of all the wonderful things that I have done. We don't always see that. Sometimes Jesus tells, and we'll see that in our lesson tomorrow, tells them to be quiet. Don't tell anyone. But here Jesus tells the man, go ahead. Tell everyone how I had compassion on you and teach them. So we see two things, the great power that Jesus has both in controlling the storm and now in casting out devils. So we can know that Jesus and God is in control of all things. Nothing happens without His guiding hand. And that should give us great faith. That should give us great comfort. So that unlike the disciples, and don't think we're any better than the disciples because I'm not, I often fail in my own faith. I think that I need to do things by my own hands. And I forget to trust in God that it's He who is guiding everything that's around me. And you can do that too. Know that God is in control of all things. Okay?